quick go through the minutes of our last meeting, January 4th. Anybody have any issues, comments, additions, deletions with those? No?
Make a motion to accept the minutes.
Okay.
January 4th.
Okay. Second on that?
Second.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay, so moved, thank you. And then we'll go to financial statements, Patty.
So I emailed you the financial statements, and I am not concerned with anything I'm seeing right now, so unless somebody has a question, what I'd like to do is move on to the profit and loss for the school lunch program that I've handed out to you tonight.
Is this a long form?
Yes, there is on the legal page.
Okay.
So the fund is just where we are for September, October, November, and December.
Is there any way to speak up a little bit? Sorry.
Pardon?
Very hard to hear.
Okay, the school lunch program for the 4 months ended December 31st, we're showing a loss of $5,368.87. That's not uncommon at this time of the year, and because we have startup costs in September and October that we have inventory for and then that we use throughout the school year. The second page is a new report that I've put together that's comparing our different levels, full lunch, full price lunch, reduced lunch, free lunch, our adult sales, our a la carte. So compared to this point last year, we're down $1,256 in revenue. We're down 544 meals. That to me is concerning. We're down 9 students, and we're down 7 days of lunch, but that's only because last year we did start in August. This year we didn't start till after Labor Day, so those 7 days will kick in at the end of the year. So right now, as I said, we are showing a loss. And if you look on the left is 16-17, and if you go down to our cost per meal, so if you look, we're averaging for the 4 months $3.62. is the cost of preparing a meal. Well, the most we get is $3.28. So the cost of preparing the meals is more than what we're charging. Except for the adult prices, which are $3.75, but those are a very minimal amount of our sales. So I've spoken to Mr. Cornish, our food service director, and he and I are gonna meet to talk about how we can possibly get this cost per meal down. It is up from last year, but that's also because we did give increases to the wages to the cafeteria staff. So he and I are going to be meeting, and we're also going to be, one thing that hasn't been done prior to me being here, and now with me being here, is we don't have a budget for the school lunch program, and I think we need to now start having a budget done for the next fiscal year and try to keep our food service directors to that budget so that we are at a break-even point.
What do other schools do, you know? And are most school lunch programs supposed to be completely self-sufficient?
Yes, but if you look at the bottom, our participation rate, the average for the 4 months is only 46.77.
Where are you getting, okay.
At the very bottom, our average daily
percentage of students in the school
that are eating lunch. And the requirements by the federal and state guidelines say that we should be at 70% participation. So we're way below participation.
What do you mean?
Do we have any idea why?
I don't know. Now, we had the same issue in Waitley, and we did do a parent survey. I believe they did both a student survey and a parent survey to see why they're not participating in our lunch programs, and that's something I can talk to Principal Heil about possibly doing, using that same type of survey and seeing what we get from the kids. I know everyone's participation has been down since the adoption of the Healthy Kids Act because we're trying to, our portions are smaller because we're supposed to only be serving 1/3 of the child's intake for the day of calories. There's all kinds of restrictions. So the kids aren't liking the lunches as much because they are supposedly healthier. So, I mean, if we have chicken nugget day or pizza day, I'm sure we're through the roof. But we can't do that every day. I mean, the Healthy Kids Act even goes as far as saying you have to serve this many vegetables a week and that only a certain percentage can be green, and a certain percentage has to be red vegetables. So the color of the vegetables is even dictated as to, so we can't serve, the kids like the green beans, and we can't have green beans every day.
Do you think people are really waking up in the morning and looking at the menu and deciding whether or not they're sending their child, the child is left us out? Not you guys, I know you guys are looking at the menu.
Sounds like.
My children pick, like they look at it for the week and pick the two or three they want each week. They also like food.
I think our meal quality is been improving in the past few years. I think the quality of the food, I think Mr. Cornish does a wonderful job promoting our program. His menus are impeccable. I just think it's a thing. What the kids want to eat and what the kids don't want to eat.
Am I wrong? My memory is that sometime in the last year we had a report about the cafeteria here and school lunches, and it was sort of a glowing report. I'm not sure if that's because maybe he was new and there was some other glowing things, but I thought it was a financially glowing thing too.
We broke even last year, so okay. That's why I'm concerned that we're now down. So we're usually down in December. By the time June comes, we're probably right at break even, but we're down 545 for meals served. That concerns me.
And you said you're down roughly nine students?
Nine students.
Is that per day?
Yes.
And roughly how many school days have we gone through?
92.
Through, so December 31st, do you know how many days it was? I can tell you.
So that's like 810.
71. There were 71 days as of December 31st when this report was.
So that if you're down nine on average per day, that would have been 630 meals. So in essence, you're truly not down. You're right.
But our costs aren't going down.
No, I understand that. I'm just saying that if you think of it in terms of
exactly
meals, you're running roughly the same or slightly ahead of last year.
And I believe the last set of letters that Mr. Cornish sent home, we had about $1,600 of unpaid debt. I don't know if that included adults or not. I think that was just the student total.
Just from this year?
Yes. Arrears.
Not from prior.
Arrears, yeah.
That would help.
Bless you.
So, is there a hand up about lunch, school lunches? No? Someone yelling?
One question regarding the cost. Is there part of the cost offset by funds from the state or the government? It is okay.
I add that in because we get reimbursement even on a full price lunch. So we are now charging $2.85 and we get about 17 cents even for the full price meals that we serve.
So Pat, you're giving us a report and an update and something to keep a watch on,
right.
But you're not telling us that you need us to delve anything or into it. But.
And just that if the school committee would like us to pursue the idea of the survey, the parent and student survey, if that's something you'd be interested in having us do.
I think it couldn't hurt.
Yeah.
It might give, you a chance to take a look at what's going on and maybe find some solution.
Okay.
As you said, it's a preference, and we heard it's a preference.
Did you do any kind of report like this for last year that would have told us the percentage of kids that are?
Yes, I just put it in a different format this year because I broke it down by the type of sale it is, whether it's free, reduced, or full price. Mm-hmm. So you're seeing each category.
Right.
Instead of all
exactly. Yep. Sales to sales.
Yep.
And when you said we're nine kids down, you meant nine kids in the school population or nine kids at lookout? So if you do, so if you have four and a half of those eating lunch every day, then that's going to tell you quite a bit about the numbers.
Right.
So in fact, it may not be that different from last year, in which case the survey is.
That's what Mr. Cutterback's saying. If I add those nine kids times the 72 days.
That's what I'm saying.
It would be about the 600 meal. It would be about 600, which we're down 544.
Right.
But those nine lunches isn't causing our costs to go down in the same.
We just have that overhead. Well, it's up to, I mean, school administration, if you want to do, spend the time on a survey, then you think it's.
I don't think it would take that much.
Even a handle or something like that?
Yeah. Something online, I don't think it would take that much to collect that data.
You can probably just talk to Mr. Christofouli and get the one he used.
Okay.
I think he did it in Survey Monkey for the parents, and it was sort of like a dot chart. He gave all the kids a dot, and they picked their favorite lunch in the hall, hung it up in the hallway.
Okay.
And that's all I have. Does anyone have any questions?
Thank you.
So, anybody have any questions about financial statements? Fire away. I'm sure we'll have budget questions for later, but. Good? Sure?
Yep.
Okay. Okay. Public comment. Yes.
Hi, I'm Maureen Antea, and I teach kindergarten. And I want to let Patty know that I'm not retiring this year.
I didn't say you were. Did I say you were?
No. But in the last month's meeting, it was brought up that, you know, we're in trouble. We're going to be in trouble over the next 2 years financially. And that if you look at somebody leaving, such as retirement, that helps. So I just wanted to let you know I'm not planning on it this year.
I don't have everybody's dates or ages. So
anyway, I just want to speak up for especially our IAs in our school. They do a tremendous job, and we count on them a lot in the course of our day. This year, there were some that were cut, there were some that left for whatever reason. And we've been down to bare bones with extra people in the school. I am just feeling now, in January, my class is kind of settled because, as you know, we've had an influx of difficult scenarios coming into preschool and into kindergarten. We're doing our best. Seeing this, the preschool and kindergarten teams have been meeting to be proactive and to look at what's coming up and to prepare ourselves, because we're here because we love our jobs, and that's why I'm not retiring, because this is what I love to do. And I was getting very discouraged at the beginning of the year, thinking, do I want to leave? Because it's getting to be overwhelming. These kids are coming in, and we don't have the people to help us. And we're just at the maximum with our time. You know, two things. My husband has no clue what I do. And he can't figure out why I come in early, why I stay late. And I think there are a lot of people out there that don't know what we really do because they're not in here. And you're all so wonderful for being on this board and wanting to help us. But you have jobs. You can't come in and spend days with us and really be in the trenches. And I'm not saying this to complain, because I wouldn't be doing this if I just wanted to complain. I want to help. And I want to put a shout out for our IAs, because they are stretched to the max. They come in and they help us. They have recess duty. They have lunch duty. They're running all over the building. And they're good people, and they're knowledgeable. I've learned a lot from the IAs that I've worked with, especially with these cases that are coming in, like special ed kind of cases that, you know, I haven't worked a lot in that field, and I'm learning so much from the people that have. So in thinking about cutting, I'm asking you, please think about the people that are directly involved with children. Please don't cut them. You know, think about technology or, you know, having speakers come in. We could put a hold on that stuff, but we can't put a hold on the children that are coming in. And I don't know why. I've been around for a while. And we have to teach them, like, skills that our kids get in the home. They're not getting that always. I'm not, you know, not all families are like that, but... And then I think technology is affecting kids' attention, and the issues that we're dealing with are so out there. We look at these children day after day after day, and we say, I don't know how to help this person, because sometimes they need more help than we have the knowledge to give them. But we're dealing with them the best that we can. So I ask you, please don't cut the people that are so important to these young children. We're the foundation, preschool and kindergarten. If we don't get it then, if they don't get it then these problems just follow them throughout the school. I've been so happy this year to get services from specialists like OTs, PTs, because a lot of these children need them, and their expertise helps these children. If we start cutting these people, we're not going to be different from schools, say, in Springfield. And when I was hired to work here, I was so proud to come here. And I was proud of the quality of teachers and education and the families and the students. And if we can't keep that up, as you were saying, Trevor, last time, people won't want to move here if this school doesn't have the reputation that it has all these years. And if we keep cutting, we can't do it all. You know, we try, but the children are going to suffer. I mean, there's a group going on right now in the preschool wing, bringing in families to help educate them how to service their children. And this is what we're running into. We not only work with the children, we have to sometimes help the families and teach them how to work with their children. So I know there's more that I wanted to say, but my mouth is so dry.
My name is Marge Pura, and I'm a kindergarten teacher here. If you can't hear me, let me know, because I have a little voice. And I'm not retiring either. I color my hair. So, and I'm not off the cuff like Maureen. I have prepared statements, if that's okay. I attended the Women's March in Boston, and I know many other teachers here do as well, in Boston, in New York, Washington, Northampton, Greenfield. And let me tell you, it was a defining moment for me. I was so illuminated by the whole thing. It gave me hope for what we face for the next 4 years. That's my political statement right there. But we took a pledge not to be complacent, and to work within our communities for what makes us stronger and not weaker. Well, I'm here tonight to fulfill that pledge, so lucky you. So there's two areas of concern that I'm looking for you to consider. Number one is for next year's kindergarten. We hope that we'll have 3 kindergartens next year. We presently have 44 children enrolled. Of what we know, there will be 9 IEPs, 5 of which have significant needs in terms of behavioral issues, as well as physical challenges for kids that come with a lot of equipment. These children come from Deerfield's preschool, and there may be unknown issues out there from other preschools in the area that we're just not aware of. So that's just the stats I have now. One teacher, one IA, work incredibly hard to reach a rigorous kindergarten standard with 18 kids. And I, every time I say this at a meeting, the rigorous curriculum of kindergarten, it sounds so crazy, but it is rigorous. More than 18 children in a class, along with children with lots of challenges, is not best practice. Keeping three kindergartens will ensure our children will have the best possible foundation for lifelong learning. My second area of consideration. First, I can't even believe we're sitting here another budget time. And once again, looking at more budget cuts. It's like deja vu. Every single year, there's something wrong here. This proposed cut of $200,000, and I'm going to say that again because it's so significant, $200,000 is inconceivable. It will be a very long time before this school will rise from the damage of a $200,000 cut. And everybody has to keep that in their heads. In my class, we use vision glasses. It's a little display. We use this. This is part of our executive function work. And I'm not going to read them for the case of it. But I'll put these glasses on. I'm going to switch to the shiny ones because the kids tell me these work better. So this is for, like, I have the kids lining up and I want them to have a vision of what a line looks like. I'm going to say, well, I'm putting my vision on. I want you to think about what I'm thinking. I don't tell them how to be in a line. I say, oh, okay, I can see this, I see that. It's quiet, except that your bodies are still, blah, blah. And I'll say, one, two, three, and they're straight line. So I'm talking less, and they're thinking more. So I have a little thing for you tonight. Bear with me. So, just for a minute here. Now, you are the gatekeepers at DES, which is an awesome responsibility, and I appreciate everything you do. But right now, I have my vision glasses on. I can't wear those because I can't read them. But I want you to envision something for me. And if you close your eyes, I want you to listen to my vision. My vision for the school is for happy children in classrooms no bigger than 18. Teachers having the help they need to assure a fun, safe, and state-of-the-art educational experience. Strong support systems that help us with the increasing challenges that our families and children face. A school that continues to celebrate the arts, foreign languages, and physical education. Finally, a school that is a reflection of the good, hard-working families of Deerfield. So I ask you, is my vision the same as your vision? Can you see it? Now take that vision and cut $200,000 from it. Think about what that cut's going to look like for that vision. In the last election, we defeated the growth of charter schools with the intention to improve our public schools. These cuts do nothing towards that end. So why did we bother? Please do not vote for this budget cut. The town of Deerfield will support this wonderful school because a great school. Great school is good for the homeowners, and it's good for our citizens. This moment in history has awakened us to the importance of rebuilding the infrastructure of our communities. DES is vital to that infrastructure. We cannot underfund our children's future and the future of Deerfield. Thank you.
Before anyone else speaks, let me just make two points. One, it's no surprise, I think, that the two people who just spoke so eloquently are kindergarten teachers. Because when I asked my 10th grader who his favorite teacher was, he says it was all downhill since kindergarten. But he did have Lori, that's true. But second, just before there's any more comments, and we need to do a better job from here, I think, explaining it. But I don't believe there is a sort of $200,000 cut on the table for the budget for next year. There was a discussion at our last meeting about how if we don't do anything with the budget that was presented for next year, given the flows in our eating up our school choice budget, that the following year we could possibly be facing that kind of cut. Now, I may have paraphrased that slightly, not perfectly, but I believe that that's it. So there, I don't, nobody here is looking at cutting $200,000 for the budget that begins July 1. So I just wanted to make that clear before we get too dire.
It's my understanding it's $100,000 for this coming budget and another $100,000 for the following. That's what I know.
So we haven't really decided that yet. What, and we'll get into that when we take a little more public comment, but if the public comment is all going to be about the budget, it may be good for us to maybe get into a budget discussion here and then go back to public comment so we don't have any more confusion before in public comment. So why don't we do that? In other words, I'm not closing in public comment, but do you have something different?
I just wanted to say from a parent's perspective that, you know, that goes along with what had been happening earlier this fall, that I don't have any children in kindergarten right now, but the climate of the school has really affected my children. So I feel like if we were to cut, my children were struggling with the climate of the school greatly. And to hear that we might have less around, and I'll be honest, I am straddling that school choice. Even though I just moved to Deerfield for this school for both of my children, I am straddling school choice to Waitley. It's a real real dire situation. I feel like somebody else said, we're starting to get better with communication and better, more in the rhythm, but it's February. And my fear is if you cut, then not to say that the special ed kids don't need that, but then my children are suffering from it. I feel like a lot of it has been focused on the kindergarten and then the other grades have been suffering. And again, it goes back to your budget, then I go in school choice, and my $5,000 or $10,000, because I have two children, goes.
Can I just ask what you mean by you don't have kids in kindergarten?
I don't have kids in kindergarten.
What do you mean when you're talking about the climate of the school as it relates to some of the issues we're having in kindergarten?
I think that all resources have been focused on those kids and trying to control those classrooms, and then what ends up happening is the more quiet kids are getting sort of to the side, and there is some bullying that's going around, and there is some lack of communication with parents. But I think that it's exhausting on one end, and the administration is trying to deal with that, and other things are going to the wayside, unfortunately.
Okay, so why don't we segue into a discussion of the budget, if we could. And I just, you handed out a new burden of fun to look at. And
if we look at.
Yeah, but I just wondered, do you have the, I don't see the front page that was a very handy where you did the,
that
percentage.
That I
got
from my other, yeah.
Yeah,
it's page 1 of 20 on the notes.
It's 2 of 20. It was the one that's written. That one.
Yeah, 2 of 20.
It isn't just the
edges.
2 of 20.
It's 2 of 20.
Sorry. Okay.
So what we've done is just provide you with an option.
We can't hear anything.
Provided you with with options. We came in originally at 2.68 increase, and we talked last time about the issue around the school choice. Because we're not having school choice in kindergarten, first, second, and third going up, that the school choice fund is sort of diminishing. So we thought we will have a shortfall, not next year, but the following year. And we had a short discussion on the possibility of kind of easing that shortfall by taking some burden on
this coming season and then some on the next. So what we did, we were very, very cautious. We asked everyone their opinion. We were very thoughtful. Janine and her team, very, very thoughtful. They made some really thought-provoking ideas to get us down from 2.68 to 2.04 with no impact on the students. So what we wanted to talk about is the option you as a school committee has to keep the budget at 2.68 or to look at some of these ideas to get down to 2.64. The ideas are pretty simple. Instead of a 5-day computer teacher, we would have a 4-day computer teacher. Instead of a 5-day, we would have a 4-day computer teacher. Instead of a 5-day librarian, we would have a 4-day librarian. And what this means is no child would lose their computer class, no teacher would lose the opportunity to have their kids in computer class, no child would lose their library time, the teachers would still have the library prep time, no change in services to the kids. We also talked about, right now we have 2.6 speech and language teachers. We would go to speech and language teachers, and they would be able to take the 50 kids that we have in this building that are coded for speech, the 39 students that receive individualized speech, half hour a month, a half hour a week, and they would be able to split that load between 2 instead of 2.6. When we looked at the Western Massachusetts average, it's about 40 per caseload. Our teachers would have 25, our speech teachers. So we thought we would look at that. The other thing we would look at is we have a position that is nowhere else in the union, nowhere else in the Frontier Regional District. It's called a reading tutor. We have 3 reading interventionists in the building already. We have 1 for the upper grades, 1 for the lower grades, and a literacy coach. We would take the position of reading tutor and offer that person a position in the library to help the librarian check in books, check out books, read to the pre-K, the K kids, bring in new books and get them all, help out in the library, because the library person would only be working 4 days. These cuts have no impact on students receiving services, no impact on the quality of education, with the exception that the reading tutor would now be working out of the library instead of doing groups and doing interventions. These are just ideas and options. The total of these cuts come to $85,000. That brings us from a 2.68 increase in our budget to a 2.04. We just wanted to offer this to the school committee. While we're looking to being sound fiscal agents here, because we know that a year from now, we'll still be back here, but it could be worse. So what Janine and her team has done with the special ed director, with
Louise,
and putting her head together in her brainstorming group, is really come up with ways that we can cut the budget and make it palatable to the taxpayers without impacting services for the students. No IAs are gone under this picture. No teachers are gone under this picture. There are 3 kindergartens under this picture. Regardless of how many students we have 3 kindergartens. We are still continuing with our full-time pre-K, our 3 pre-Ks, and three of every grade except the ones we have 2 in. And so we're not really cutting anything dramatic or that would impact any student. And I really want to say that to all of you. These were very mindful cuts.
and I'm proud of the fact that we can offer this to the school committee to make a decision and offer it to you by saying, we understand the needs. We get that these kids, we get that the IAs are irreplaceable, indispensable. We get that these kids have high needs. We know what's going on in the building. I know what's going on in the building. We know it, and we know the needs, and we want to continue with the reputation of this school as being a fine institution where people want to bring their kids because it's Deerfield. But on the other hand, I also have to be prudent and offer an option to the school committee. So again, let me reiterate that. 4 days of library with a library aide or a library assistant, who would not be a tutor but an assistant, but still be working with us every day, 4.5 hours. 4 days of computer education, 2 full-time speech and language people for the 50 students in our caseload, and that's it. So no classrooms cut, no IAs cut, everybody's safe, we understand the needs. And I hope that helps. But the final decision is our school committee, and it's between them. If they want 2.68, we'll go forward, we're fine. If they want 2.5, if they want 2.4 or 2.04, but what we can do this year will help us next year. I just want to tell you that. Yes.
My name is Megan Donovan, and I am a parent of 2 children here, was an IA, now in the long-term sub in the computer lab for the second year, and on the PTA, so I kind of knew it all. So, and as a parent perspective, I can appreciate those things that you just discussed not impacting students directly. And as the long-term sub in the computer lab, I can also reiterate that there's some times in there where there are not active classes coming through, likewise in the library. So as a parent perspective, I see that as a very good solution to part of the problem there. It seems like a good place to approach that because having been in there for 2 years, I can see how time could be cut back in that area without impacting students. And I can't speak for the library's speech or whatever, but I do know that there is room there in the computer lab where there are not active classes coming through, and I can see that being a reasonable solution. I just wanted to offer that up.
Thank you so much. Thank you. We wanted to make sure every child still has the same library time, every child still has the same computer time. Computers and technology are becoming so important, and we're striving really hard to provide that in this building. And when we see things that aren't working, we fix them. And that's Janine, who fixes them. And but we understand these kids, the technology is, they're digital natives. We have to really continue. There's 21 classrooms in the building. So there's 21 classrooms that go to library for 40 minutes and 21 classes that go to computer. But there's prep involved and this sort of thing. But we know we can do it in 4 days and do it well.
Can I just bring it back here for a second? I won't ignore you. But it might be helpful. I hope it's not just for me that this is helpful. But I'm wondering, Patty, if you can describe again the problem that we were looking at.
Sure.
And how that comes about in that following year relating to, I believe, our school choice accounts.
Right. Well, if you go to page 19 of 20.
Yeah.
So if you, this is our school choice account. In fiscal year 16, the money we received was $647,624. That's the money that we're spending in fiscal year 17 because we spend a year in arrear.
Spending it right now in this school year.
In this school year, but we received it in 16.
Right.
But if you look for the projected FY18, the revenue that we're earning this year is $453,752. That is a significant decrease, approximately $200,000, which is why I think that the miscommunication. We have a $200,000 revenue decrease in our school choice.
And let me just interrupt you just quickly. Did we have a bump up for some particular sort of one-time reasons up to that 647?
No.
For 16?
It's just...
So the year before that, was that much due?
Yes.
Because I remember that number being
And our
closer
numbers
to
are trending
five.
Down because the number of our school choice students, we started 3 years ago to not accept school choice to the level that we were, because we were trying to right-size our school for the native population. And what had happened in the past was that we would fill an entire third section with school choice.
I understand that.
Okay.
I just thought that that there was, for some reason, we had a lot more. I don't know if it was related to a special ed issue.
We did.
Or,
from my projection, my early projections don't include sped bumps, because those don't come till June. So
okay,
when we look at this, I had only projected 614, and we got 647, because when we fill out the sped increment in June, that's when that money gets allocated to us. In December, they only give us credit for the sped increments of the children we had the preceding year, and they take away the sixth graders who left. They don't know the new school choice if that any of them are going to have sped. So in December, it's usually lower.
So our projected revenue that we're going to get for this year, the 453 that you mentioned, mm-hmm, is that possibly going to get a bump up that we're going to hear about
it
at
could
the end of the school year? Okay. And but we don't know.
Right. But so my point is, right, regardless if we get bumped up another 30 grand for a sped increment, we have $527,000 worth. Oh, I'm going to say 520 of salaries. You're also funding the Arts Partnership, $7,500 out of that. So $520,000 in salaries is more than what we're taking in, and those salaries are going to increase. So the recommendation I made to the school committee was, do we want to take some of these services that we're paying from school choice and move it on to the town budget over 1 or 2 years? And that is what you guys said, let us think about that, and when we come back in February,
see what you have.
We'll see what we have. So, as Dr. Carey just explained, she and Janine and other directors, educational directors in the district, came up with these proposals. A couple other things I do want to point out to you is, right now, on page one, when I printed this yesterday, we had 45 kindergarten registrations with 11 identified as IEPs, and I believe Janine's saying that number's now up to 49.
And that's just strictly Deerfield registrations.
There are 43 residents and 6 current school choice who are either
siblings
or children of employees.
Okay. That's going to be my one question.
49.
And just a quick enrollment question, because I was looking at the numbers. Pre-K shows 8 school choice, 4 boys, 4 girls, and interest. So I'm just trying to get an understanding. Are those also siblings, or are they, it's just the nature of the program that we run, that they're in here from other districts?
Some are.
Because we offer the full day program,
yes,
for the district.
Yes. They're tuition. We don't get any school choice
okay,
money for
so this, that's what, right.
Right, right.
They're tuition, pardon me. So they would not necessarily, the tuition ones are not necessarily part of your
correct
48.
Yes. They can't be, because they're pre-K.
Right.
Yes.
Correct.
They would go back to their home school.
Mm-hmm.
The other piece of information that I wanted to relay to the committee was, looking at the governor's early budget, nothing has been announced, but it is looking like there are cuts to the early childhood, childhood department, ECC, I think it's called, or EEC, early education, EEC. That could mean that we could be losing, potentially, depending on what gets passed, $36,000 worth of funding that we get for our pre-K. It's my understanding that the governor feels that those monies that were earmarked, we get money in our foundation budget now, we're getting credit, so it's sort of like a double dipping. I don't know if this is going to go through, and we don't know the financial impact. We get 36 currently, we could get 30 and then 15 and then nothing over the next 3 years, or all 36 could be gone in 18. So that's another $36,000 worth of funding. We did speak with our sped director, and we do have money in our sped revolving fund, so if we get dropped 6 or 36, we do have a one-year fix for 18 by using some funds for FY 18. But it also needs to be something that we are mindful of for FY 19.
I just have another question relating to sort of part of the strategy, I guess, but partly this memo you've provided us here. Mm-hmm. It seems to me that our request to the town should remain a 2.68 request, and that the savings that we're trying to achieve are savings that should be on the school choice budget, so that that's held into an account to be used for next year.
So I didn't want to make that assumption. So okay. If you are saying to me, okay, that's great, we'll take these considerations, right. But then take more money from school choice and put it back on the town budget to bring us back up to the 2.68, and I can do that.
Okay, when you say take money,
we need to start transitioning, I think, money that we're spending on.
I'm just saying that the budget, you brought us a very reasonable budget. A month ago. Mm-hmm. That's all I'm saying.
Yep.
And so any cuts that we're trying to do here to sort of smooth out the bump for the next cycle, mm-hmm. It seems those are sort of in-house school choice things that we should be doing. But we should still be asking the town for our reasonable 2.68 increase. Mm-hmm. That's all I'm
right.
saying.
So, to get from the 2.0, to get from 268 to 204,
yeah.
It was reducing the budget by $28,616. So if you want 2.68, I will go and look and see what is in the budget in school choice and move 28,616 and put it back on the town appropriation and bring that back up to 2.68.
We should start moving some, whatever we're doing every year, you know, instead of paying it in school choice, we should move it to where it should be. Like you said, you were talking earlier, it should be, you know, it should be shown where it's supposed to be coming from if it's an annual cost.
Well, they're all annual.
They're all annual, though.
Well, I know, but we're paying a lot of what we do out of that school choice, and that's disappearing. It's going to keep dropping. We're going to wind up at some point in a really bad, you know, next year with $200,000 for cuts or what. Sometime we've got to pay for that because we can't, mm-hmm. You know, the town's going to have to, the town doesn't have a lot of places to go get it either.
Exactly.
You know, it's not coming into us either. So, you know, we got the cherry sheets and it's, you know, it shows it there, the cuts as well. So, but I do think that, you know, realistically it should show where we're spending this money. You know, we're kind of hiding it from the town with the school choice. I mean, they see it, obviously, but we should show it.
Well, and that's why we added that secondary, the other funding. So the first pages are the town appropriation budget by line, but then starting on page 11 of 20, we're showing the entire budget with all our revenue sources.
Okay.
So if you look at page 18 of 20, we're requesting from the town $4.6 million, but we're really, our total budget will be at $5.5 million. So they're representing 83% of our total budget.
Yeah.
So I don't know if they read it, but we do show it.
Yeah.
No, they read it and they expressed appreciation that we finally have the funding sources identified.
Yep. And I think
Mr. Olmsted has expressed.
Well, and I think it's also helpful for you as a school committee not to just look at, you know, when you're looking at certain areas, that IAs, teachers, whatever the bucket is, that you're not just seeing the town appropriation, that you're seeing all the entire cost of our
right.
staffing.
Right.
Yeah. Could I interject for a minute? I'd like to try and talk a little bit about school choice and how we've arrived at where we are so that the audience can get somewhat of an appreciation of why we're having these discussions the past 2 or 3 years. Over time, we had a situation, we had 3 classrooms per grade in this school, and we were always able to offer school choice and fill those rooms out, fill the classrooms out to provide us with some extra revenue. And back 20 plus years ago when school choice started,
It was a wonderful program, and we were generating $400,000 or $500,000 a year that we were able to use for improvements within the school. Over time, that $400,000 or $500,000 a year has increasingly become earmarked for what I'll call, in large measure, unfunded mandates from the state and the needs that you've very eloquently addressed tonight about the changing dynamics and changing needs of the student populations coming into the school. So those, what I'll call special education needs, for lack of anything better to call them, have been absorbed by school choice. The problem that we have is kind of a twofold thing. One is we're spending school choice money that's generated at the cost of $5,000 per student per year, when we have a school budget that's costing us somewhere in the neighborhood of $13,600 per student per year. So the voting population, who's mindful of their tax, the tax implications of the school budget, which is about 70 to 80% of the total town's budget between the two schools, looks at that and says, we're bringing these kids in at five, we're spending 13.6 on them. That does not make economic sense. So 3 years ago, when it was really brought to our attention, we came to the realization that we were potentially inflating the need for three classrooms per grade. We started to look at how many students or how many classes per grade level we could have with our native population. I'll give a few examples, and because they're the farthest along and really at the back end of when we were just having school choice. We have a fifth grade that has 45 students from the town of Deerfield in it and has a total of 15 school choice students, taking us up to a total class population of 20 per class of 60 kids. If I go down one grade, we have 35 kids in the fourth grade with 17 students, taking us up to 52. That's a class that could very easily have been taught from about the second grade on with two classroom teachers and aides. And those are the types of things that the finance committee looks at, that the townspeople talk about, and that the school committee started to realize 2 or 3 years ago is a serious issue, because school populations are going down. Our native population is going down. Now the problem is, when we start in kindergarten, you've talked about it, 18 students is a pretty big kindergarten classroom. At what age do you possibly move up towards 20 students or 22 students or whatever? We've had a stated ratio, from my recollections over the 25 to 30 years I've been doing this, of about 25 students per grade would be the maximum we'd want to see. What I would call the upper levels. But where do those breaks take place? With 45 students in third, fourth, fifth, and sixth grade, we don't need three classrooms in my estimation. Maybe in kindergarten, first and second, we do. But these are areas that we can realize savings, and if we don't have the extra population, we may not have the special education needs, and there's a rollback that the town starts to see, and some of the conversation goes away. I've been a proponent of school choice throughout the opportunity to take advantage of the program. I believe that student parents should have the opportunity to put their kids where they want to. I mean, I teach at an independent school, so I'm another option to the school choice option, but it's just something that we have to look at. And, you know, there are no easy answers, but we've got ourselves in a position where we've come to rely on school choice money, and it's not going to be there. There's no way we can continue to do what we've done and sustain it over the coming years, and God knows what's going to happen with school choice. So that's just I hope, a somewhat clarification of school choice and how we've gotten to the point we're at.
Very, very well said, and it's happening everywhere. It's not just Deerfield. It's Waitley, it's Sunderland, it's all across the state. Every you know, school committee convention I go to, it, you know, all has the same problem. Declining enrollment, poor mandates, you know, from the state. Teachers are relying to, you know, ask to teach and be a, you know, psychologist and family therapist and every other thing. It's really tough.
I think the last piece of that school choice pie too, and when we talk about that, it's not an issue that affects Eastern Mass. It's a very Western Mass type of situation. So we don't have the political clout in Western Mass to get that $5,000, which it's been $5,000 for 20 years.
Right.
But yet the charter tuitions are set based on what the actual resident schools are spending, plus, 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 with no accountability.
Correct.
So if choice is choice, be it school choice, charter, why isn't it funded the same?
Right.
So, and I think that's the other piece that we really have to struggle with. And because we're in Western Massachusetts, we don't have the political clout to change that.
Yep. That's awesome.
All right, a few hands, so why don't we throw it back to the back row?
About one thing, I just wanted to reiterate, Linda Gavin, I'm one of the speech language pathologists in the building, and I'm primarily in the preschool population. And I just wanted to say that if you do cut one of the speech positions or part of a position, it will change how services are provided.
So
maybe you're looking at a different model, but services won't be the same. And I'm not sure what number Dr. Carey gave, because I just got notified this afternoon that this proposal was going to be made tonight. But I know my caseload is around 20 students, which I know is low. But I also have quite a few nonverbal students. As of this week, I have three new kids that are coming in this week that our early childhood coordinator just told us that they're turning three. So that puts me to 23 students. That number doesn't include RTI students, response to intervention groups. That number doesn't include 504 students, probably. I don't know, I'm just assuming. I'm not sure where that number came from. I'm just talking from my caseload, but I just wanted you to know that there are other services that would be affected by that. And yes, I do think that our numbers in our school are lower than what you might find in Springfield or Holyoke, or I'm not sure all what districts they surveyed. But I really take pride in the progress that our kids make and the services they get here at Deerfield. And just wanted to make you aware of that, that it would affect how services are provided.
Thank you.
Speech.
That's not, the pre-K budget is not our on our budget, is it?
Yes.
Initiatives entirely.
Right. Once a child turns 2.9 years of age, they become the responsibility of the public schools if they are in need of speech and language, OT, PT. It is our responsibility. So we either service them here, or we pay a consultant to service them where they are. So that's why we have the pre-K model that we do, so that it's inclusive.
I understand that, but in our budget that we're dealing with today, do we have the entire pre-K budget here?
The town appropriation pays for one teacher.
Yeah.
The grant that I just talked about and tuitions pay for two other teachers. But if you look at the full town appropriation, you will see the full amount for the early childhood. So yes, it's represented.
It is represented.
Yes.
Sorry.
Who's
had your hand up?
Oh,
no, I don't.
Okay, moving on. Thank you. My name is Ashley Dennis. I'm the parent of two children here. I have the pleasure of having a kindergartner in Santa's class. I'm a fourth grader in Mrs. Smith's class, and it's wonderful. Dr. Carey, the budget that you spoke of seemed a very considered change as needed to go forward. Clearly, the business side of these things are really important. We can't go forward if the dollar cents isn't there. And I really appreciate the clear acknowledgement that you gave to the importance of the teachers and the IAs who are really in the trenches and making all that difference, because I see the result of that in my kids. One thing I did want to ask, or just I clearly don't know enough about it, but just to raise the question, when you spoke of the speech language pathologist, I know they each have caseloads, but there are other services, as Mrs. Scavin referenced a little bit, other services like assessments, evals, parent concerns, those kinds of things that I think need to be taken into consideration, most especially because speech is something that needs to be addressed early. Any concerns that are raised really need to be, have the interventions at those early ages. So just to consider, have that peace in mind. It's, I think for that area, it's not just the caseload, but all of the areas that come up as concerns arise and stuff like that, to be able to have that flexibility to respond to the student population. Thank you.
Yes.
Quickly, do you remember last year or the year before?
Could you put
I want you to feel my vision here. I do remember our talk about school choice in the past that you had, Ken, I think you had mentioned that maybe we could use it as a backfiller for certain classes. So if you had like 16 kids in each class, that you fill it up to 18 or whatever.
That's what happened, yes.
It could be, so instead of just bringing siblings in, maybe you could bring in more school choice to help offset some of the things going on. Just not to top it up to 25, but maybe just to top, because it doesn't change the cost. So you're getting 10,000 and you're bringing two more in. So 10,000 is better than
But yeah. That's the slippery slope we've been looking for. So if we took this year's,
excuse me, I gotta call it back up if I can figure out how to get this thing open on short notice. if you took this year's native class of 45 kindergartners, and we added siblings and faculty students onto that as school choice, we added 7. That puts us at 52.
49
with 6 siblings.
So that includes
6.
Yes.
43 native, 6 school choice.
45 and 7. 52. What am I looking at? Kindergarten? What's that?
You're looking at the current. I was looking at the projected kindergarten.
Oh, okay. No, I'm just saying. I just wanted to take this year as an example for you. In the past, we would have said, go for it. You know, bump it up. Well, to 54 would put you at 18 per class. If we do that, we go to grade 1, and we add just 2 people move into town. Now you're at 56. We're a little bit beyond the ability when you get to second, third, and fourth grade of dropping back to possibly 2 classroom sections. And at least from this individual's perspective of student teachers. And I don't want to see us at 24 and 25 kids per class. But it's just, we had some really low populations come to the school. We may be back on the upswing in spite of what the demographics information that we've got say. The town of Deerfield may be experiencing something that our population may hold. We don't know. But the intent was to try and scale back so that we were servicing primarily native and not adding a lot of the school choice. I don't disagree with that. I said it. $5,000 is $5,000. If you've already got all the staff in here. But if we're carrying a third classroom, which we did for probably 4 or 5 years for no apparent reason except to bring in school choice, then we're losing money because we're spending $13,500 to get 5. And it doesn't work. And that's what's not sustainable.
Just one more question. The Power School program, the new technology we have, how much is that costing per student? You know what now?
I don't have the, it is a per student cost, which is the better deal than what we were paying with our previous one. It is lower cost than the previous one that we did with Redeker, but I can get that information for you.
I mean, I've been researching online, it was anywhere from 10 to 20 per student, and I'm saying to myself, well, listen, I can do the attendance on paper again, and I'd be happy to keep my report cards just the way they are. So if that's a place we can save a few $1,000,
unfortunately, unfunded mandate, because the state made it. One of the reasons we switched was because the state wants to come in and just take our EPIMS and SIMS instead of us transferring it up. Redeker, there was a Redeker was saying they were compliant. The state was saying they weren't compliant. So I agree with what you're saying, but that's another unfunded mandate. They're saying you have to have a system where we can come in and suck your data.
Are they going to have some helps uploaded to you and if we get your report cards?
I don't know if they're going to do that.
I just want to add one thing to what you said there, that you should know that in the spring, at some point, the administration goes through and looks to see whether there are some places to add school choice in those upper grades. Yeah, not to add another classroom.
Right.
But
yeah.
So that backfilling that you mentioned does happen.
Yes.
But of course, from what we've heard from you, we don't want to open school choice at all to the newer grades, kindergarten coming in, given what we're hearing about wanting to keep those numbers as low as possible.
So,
the backfilling that's available is really
less.
Right. More numbers.
It usually does. Yeah. You buy a few more.
Kids. Yeah.
So the numbers we're talking there, I mean, probably a handful. So that's 5 to 20,000, 25,000 maybe. Anyone else? Hands?
No, I can make another, just make another comment if I could.
Kent would like to make another.
The lab comment here. I'd like to compliment the administration about finding cuts that don't, on paper, reduce services to students. I hear the comment in the back about, yes, you've only got 20 students, but the needs of these students are considerably different than maybe in the past, or it could be considerably different. We don't know what those needs are, and unfortunately, at this time of year, it is a numbers game. So if you look at, which they've done, the numbers of students, the staffing that's here, and they've found areas where they can potentially cut without affecting, on paper, mind you, the time that students get with the services, and we're not cutting services. That to me is a win-win. Unfortunately, it does mean the potential for added stress on the existing staff if those needs become significantly different. But I think at the same time, the administration would turn around and come in and say we need to adjust to accommodate that, and then we have to go back either to the town or to our budgets and try and find ways to fund it. We're not here to cut positions. The last thing in the world we want to do is cut positions. I've been proud over the years of the job this school does, finding ways to address needs early on. I mean, there are still a few faces in here I recognize on the faculty and staff. I don't get in the schools, I apologize for that, but I've got other things to do during the day. But the focus on early intervention began 25 years ago in this school and has been supported by the school committee and the administration consistently, and the town has always risen to back us up to the best of their abilities. Reading specialists, my neighbor is one of the reading specialists, and she was the first one hired, weren't you? I see her back there. And when we started that program, that was new. I mean, it was something that hadn't been done. When we started the daybreak program, which is now called what?
Or
what's that? Right. That was groundbreaking. The concept of keeping students in district that had, you know, high cost needs by creating a program with the personnel to do it and charge tuition so that other school districts could find a less or more cost effective way of dealing with that same population. And it enabled us to keep it all in-house and save money. These are all things that have consistently been done by the administration in this district and particularly in this town. We've been the benefactors because we're the biggest in the union and we had the space to take these things on. And so what you're hearing are creative ways to deal with budgetary issues while maintaining the services that we've developed over time. And I heard you say it's not quite the atmosphere you were expecting, but you're going to have a hard time going outside of Union 38, and you're just lucky that there's a neighboring school that you can consider for school choice, because you can't find it outside this district. And it's a tribute to these people sitting here, so I just, I'll get off my soapbox.
Can I just add on one of the things that you said? You had commented about, would it change some of the needs, and if there were a point when administration that we noticed that there was going to be a need to come back to you and to make another recommendation. We've done that, and you have always been very supportive and open to that, and we did that twice this year, in the beginning of the school year, where we came back to you and said, we really need this early childhood behavior interventionist, and you supported that, and you added it, Dr. Carey's support. We came back to you this year and said, it's not working, the students need more, we need another instructional assistant, and again, you did that. So we absolutely constantly reflect the programs and the needs of the students and what they're getting. And we would have no hesitation to do that, knowing how supportive you have been in the past. So thank you.
Can I add one other comment also to what Mr. Cuddebeck? Not just here at Deerfield, but Conway and Sunderland. Our SPED director, Karen Ferrandino, since her arrival, she's created specialized programs in each of the elementaries. And right now, we have no pre-K to six children in out-of-district placements. None.
That's huge.
That is huge.
Very huge.
And we have to keep mindful that the Frontier, we're struggling a little bit because they're coming up and we don't have the programs at Frontier yet, but we will. But that saves money to the towns as well when they get to Frontier, because now we're servicing them in district placements, and the money doesn't go up, and then the towns are overburdened also with assessments from Frontier. So I think our SPED director has done a wonderful job building the programs, and it's also attracted other area school districts to tuition into our programs, which also creates a revenue source.
Okay. Any other comments, Lori?
I think there's a lot of great thought behind some of the budget thought process. I think looking at the computer and library right now, it seems like that could be a 4 day a week job. We were thinking about classes and it wouldn't have any impact on kids. I'm working in special ed right now. I know how kids come up all the time, and I appreciate the fact that the administration is willing to come and say, actually, we need to, add a person. But I think that sometimes, is it possible to be a little bit, we're seeing a trend in what's happening with these kids. We're seeing the early intervention and the young kids, all these kids popped up this year that, we didn't know about, and we were able to come back and ask school committee for positions. But, like Maureen said, and parents are saying that it caused a lot of disruptions in the school early on. So. When you're thinking about the budget, I understand there's numbers on papers. I also know some of the speech and language teachers, they go into classrooms and they do whole group
communication
and social skills and social thinking. So I don't know if that was considered in their caseload, but I just, if it's possible to think about, rather than having to come back, a few months in, to ask for the SLP to be back in place or whatever those positions are. That's just something to think about and consider.
I think my immediate response to that would be, from my perspective, and I only speak as one member, is if we can save the money now, because we're losing flexibility in the school choice funds we have available to answer the needs that she talked about, I'd rather save it now and be able to react to specific needs in the fall and continue programs continue resource levels that may not be specifically what are needed. It's easier for us to adapt to specific needs than it is to try and adapt to needs with existing resources that may not fit what she needs.
I'm just wondering too if the social skills and the other in-class services that the SLPs are providing are considered. So if that's not, then there might be some.
I can jump in too. With the social skills, yes, there have been some whole class lessons. With that, we've talked a lot about building capacity this year, and our related service providers have done an excellent job, OT included, pushing into classrooms to focus on some of those skills. But with the moving capacity, we're looking at fading out. Special education liaisons, classroom teachers, those are things that can be built in and integrated throughout the regular day in the curriculum. I don't know if you want to tag on to that or not.
We also hired the ECBI specialist, and she's also doing social skills. So,
can we not use the acronym so that we know?
Early childhood.
I got it. Early childhood behavioral intervention, I assume, but.
Our school adjustment council, if we're looking at just social skills across the board, a lot of people are kind of picking up that need, if you will. I know Lori's actually taken on a social skills group. I think that's picked up with other service providers.
Counselor, the school psychologist,
myself.
And it was, you know, one of the things that kind of drew us to it also was the audit that was done few years back when Marty was here.
Last spring.
Yes.
Targeted.
Those were areas that were brought to our attention in terms of areas that we could look at if we had to reduce.
I'm going to say one last thing and we can go back there, but I take these budget conversations seriously, but I also take great satisfaction in hearing the passion of our faculty, the passion of our parents for the quality of education we offer in the school. And, you know, we work hard the administration works hard to achieve that, and God knows the faculty and staff go above and beyond to maintain the reputation that this school has. So.
When people come into the classrooms and do the social skills work, it's not just for the special needs kids. It's the entire classroom, the entire school benefits from that work.
Yep.
So it's not just for the kids who are on the, you know, in special needs. It really is a benefit to the entire school. So it is a necessary thing.
We're struggling. It's struggling. We're struggling. As a parent, that's a major issue.
What is?
The social.
One last thing.
Yeah.
I hear what Kate and Sheena are saying about her people hopping in. We hop in a lot. But sometimes we hop in so much that it's overwhelming sometimes. I mean, we try to give as much as we can to supplement where those holes are. But don't forget, we have another layer up here. Mm-hmm. The curriculum gets bigger and bigger and bigger, and the demands of families are bigger. So we're kind of squished in the middle here. So, I mean, I think we love our school, and we're all here long hours. We're here during the weekend just to get the simple jobs done, because you never have time to even change a bulletin board. So, we are giving the extra. If someone needs extra help, you need to lose your IA to go hop into another recess. Yes, you can do that. If you have to substitute for another specialist class, like in our class, I sent someone else today that did that. So we all make those adjustments all the time. But we have such a push and such a huge curriculum to satisfy for the town and for this state that there's a breaking point. And I think when we talk about budget cuts, and we're all feeling this, and you're feeling that as a parent, and mm-hmm. I get that. Mm-hmm. I think it's like a critical mass right now, and I think we can't ignore it. And I don't think this is a simple answer for it, but I just want you to acknowledge that it's here. We are maxed out. We are trying to give more. When you take more, we're giving more. And then we get more from the top. So it's exhausting. And I'm gonna tell you right now, there's not one kid in this school that doesn't get something. We work to get them to those benchmarks at the end of the year, and they do get at those benchmarks. And it's on our backs. And we accept a 1% raise every year when other school systems are getting 3-4% raises sometimes. But we love this system. We love this community. All we're asking for is respect, to understand the workload that we carry with us every single day, every weekend, every night. So.
I
just want to say that what these teachers are representing shows every day in the students' experience, and I don't want to diminish your experience in any way whatsoever, because everybody has a different experience, but and every student will in the same setting. But what I see every time I come into the school is that caring and that love and that extra hard work shows in the population. And I, as a parent of two here, I'm really proud of the teachers and everything they do. Thank you. Done.
Thank you.
All right. Well,
I have
two questions. Okay.
So I just want to know what our charge is now, as far as what you want to present for the next, but what you like us to prepare. So my two questions are, one, are you accepting these reductions of 85,167, and do you want us to re-prepare the town appropriation request to reflect 2.68% increase?
So we should discuss it, obviously. Yeah. Certainly the second part of what you said, I would hope we would agree on pretty easily about the 2.68 and where that comes from. Mm-hmm. As to the specific cuts that you proposed here, we haven't really talked about them, and I don't know that we're qualified to really go pick at them in terms of the knowledge and real impacts that they have. You know, as Ken says, you guys work hard to come up with these cuts, and so presumably you have run through various options. You know, so it's hard for me to evaluate whether the speech is I was hearing some concerns there that's more of a cut than it sounds like. Whether you have thought about, if that really isn't taking away from the kids' needs, then it's good to know. If it was, then did you think about sort of, I don't know, a different position that is more general to the school that can be filled in?
Really, what we need is, a percentage. If you want to stay at 2.68 or you want to go?
She
said what we need, what they need, the administration needs to know is, do we want to stay at 2.68% or do figure out something relative to the cuts that were presented tonight that would result down to 2.04%. And
the first question was, are you accepting the reductions of 85,167? And if the answer is yes, then I'm going to adjust the budget back
2.04.
That the 85,167 all is taken from school choice, and our town appropriation request reflects the additional 28,616 and goes back up to 2.68%. Those are my questions.
Yep. Yes. So I'm fine with that. I was getting more into the details of those cuts as opposed to just the number. But I think the number, given the way you've described it, the feasibility of doing it, probably sounds in the ballpark, just from the impacts that I've heard. But I don't know if anyone else wants to chip in.
May I ask, do we have time for myself to think about it, to have conversations? Is something needs to be done this evening?
We will have another meeting prior to...
No, we have a public hearing next
March 1st. And somewhere in between now and March 1st, I would imagine the FinCom from Deerfield will ask us to come and appear and present. We've got to get our request into the town.
Right. They're waiting for
our next meeting.
Yeah. Before we have a public hearing. But we're going to have a public hearing before we have a final budget.
Right.
So I'm just saying to Jan that this is what we're doing tonight is not the final budget. So in a sense, there is some time to think about specific cuts and the impact of these, which is a separate question from the percentage.
Correct.
Which I think is, I'm fine with the reduction in dollars. Mm-hmm. No, call it that. But I don't. I'll let other people speak to that.
So you're fine with being at 2.04%?
No. I'm fine with our Overall, but, yeah, yes, yes and no.
Overall being 2.04, but the town being 2.68.
Right, because what we're trying to do is we're flatten out
some of that.
We're trying to save it. We need savings to put towards school choice funds to flatten it out for the next year.
Correct.
So the town doesn't get hit next year, and we all get
right, it smooths it out for the town, and it smooths it out for the school.
So the recommended decreases tonight, you're in favor?
I second that.
And Jan, but Jan is concerned and wants time to think.
I think
correct.
About the...
If it's possible.
About...
Is it, anything's possible.
Can I just clarify about the specific dollar amounts or about where those dollars are going to come from?
I guess I would say both. I came late, and I'm just curious whether I'd be able to consider it. I'm asking.
Again, we are going to describe the process again. We're going to have a March meeting, which you're saying before that March meeting, we will sit with FinCom about the number.
Yep.
And we have to submit something to them prior to them calling us so that they'll have it to review and have questions ready when we appear. So whatever you're going to tell me to do tonight, I'm going to send to the town administrator tomorrow.
Yep.
So, yeah.
And that's our usual process. Mm-hmm. That's not changing anything.
Yeah. And that doesn't, I mean, it goes to the finance committee, but it will, you'll have the opportunity in a subsequent public hearing in March, yeah, whatever the hell,
March. It's March 1st.
March 1st.
To still consider
to make any changes,
what the final number is that we end up at.
Because it's really the town that's got to go there.
Because between now and the time we might meet with the finance committee or the finance committee discusses things, there could be other changes that take place.
Yeah.
So it's a very fluid process this time of year.
Yeah.
And just to kind of give a little bit more information, the districts that we've looked at in terms of comparing caseloads for SLPs, as I mentioned, the average caseload was about 40, there's some districts, 40 to 60, 28 to 30. Those are districts that have, they have SLPs, they have an OT, a PT, and then they have a school psychologist or a school adjustment counselor. Most typically, the school psychologist, in some of these cases, are just doing testing and the assessment. We really have looked with our new team that we have here, including the new ECBI, how we can, because of the increased needs in developing students' social skills and the deficits that they have, how we can use more experts in our building and not just rely on SLPs.
Right.
In the past, typically in some schools are taking on that load. And we have ECBI doing that. We have the school counselor doing that. We have the psychologist doing that. We do have SLPs doing that. So we have to look at doing a different model.
Yeah.
There are some students that we are servicing on a one-to-one basis or a one-to-two-one basis. And we have to look at that too. And we've had some professional development on differentiation. We have to consider different service delivery models. But if currently we have 50 students who have SLP speech in their IEP,
mm-hmm.
39 are on CGRID, remaining are on V-GRID, which means push-in, secret is pull-out. But we have really been trying to look at the positions that we have and sharing delivery of services. I don't know if you have anything else to add. To divide and conquer, because we all need to be able to develop those skills.
Right.
In the students.
So we talked, and I apologize if I missed this, we've talked about the various cuts here, but I noticed that there's been an additional amount of money put in for library assistant.
So it's a reduction of the tutor, but we're asking the tutor to take the, we're offering the position of the part-time library assistant, so the savings, the net between the elimination of the tutor and the addition of the 0.5 IA in the library.
Okay.
What we're looking for is a direction. What would you like to see
no,
us
I understand.
Do?
Yeah.
There would have to be a percentage.
Yeah, yeah. So, Jan, I think we're sort of saying we need to go forward with a number.
Okay.
I would make a motion to move ahead with the numbers that are in the memo presented by Pat to the school committee.
So you're making a motion to proceed with a net 2.04 with the town appropriation remaining at 2.68.
Yeah. Can I rephrase that?
Yes.
What's that?
Could I rephrase that?
You can rephrase it to what you want it to be.
That Trevor's making a motion to accept the reduction of $85,167 from school choice.
Yes.
And the town appropriation to be 2.6, a request of a 2.68 increase.
Yep.
Get rid of the 2.4.
Oh, okay. Yeah. 85,000. That's fine.
And so with that, we know next year it won't be as, as painful as.
We'll have another year trying to do this kind of thing.
Right.
Well, we'll have greater clarity on school choice. But.
Yeah.
Is there a second? Who seconded?
I could second.
All right.
That's okay.
Don't worry. Any further discussion? No?
Second.
All in favor?
Oh.
All in favor? Here?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Aye. For the vote? Okay. Yeah. Who wants to talk?
Yeah, I had a question. It's our superintendent has brought up a couple times that this may get more painful down the road, and it seems like the cuts that you're proposing today, from what we've heard from parents and teachers, seem doable, that they're cutting back on some areas where we have some room, but that seems like that's cutting us pretty close to the bone for these, what has been mentioned a couple times as painful, potentially painful meetings a year from now or 2 years from now. Are any of you concerned with where this positions us, should further cuts or more painful conversations come?
So can I maybe make a broad statement, just because of the words that we're using. So, believe me, we all up here appreciate everything you all do, you know, tenfold. But I think, I just want to throw out there, just so that we're all thinking about this, that since I've been here, we haven't, the budget always goes up. So it's really not cuts that we're talking about. And I don't want you to take this at all in the wrong way, but I know, Marvin, you mentioned something about a 1% increase in salary, I think you said. The numbers, really, that doesn't build in the numbers. And, you have to understand, politically in this town, I don't think we're ever going to get more than a 2.5%, maybe up to 3%, that would be very rare, political sort of increase in our budget. So we're always sort of bumbling along at a 2 to 2.5% increase every year in our overall budget. But the salary costs is, this year alone, I think, is about 3% if you just look at the steps combined with the contract. So it seems to me that we're all doing ourselves not a great favor by not somehow coming together and just smoothing that out. Because if it was smoothed out, right, then we're not making what we call cuts, because our budget's always going to go up. And the question is, and we want the budget, the school budget, to go up because we want everybody to be paid more than any other district if possible. But I guess you need to understand the concept is that those costs are going up greater than the percentage, the budget percentage that we ever get from the town. And so we should think about that, because since I've been here, there's a lot of just angst and stress about these budgets times, because we're always sort of chipping away a lot of our great things that we love about the school and programs. But you got to remember, collectively, all of us, that our budget is going up. We are funding this school at a greater level every year. So it's just a sort of conceptual thing that I wondered if we were able to, somewhere down the road, get it smoothed out, we would all be able to get rid of some of the stress, keep increasing our worth and our support of teachers, and not have this sort of annual stress. That's all I can say, because we all feel it, and none of us like it. So I just wanted to say that, and I'm not taking away anything you said, but just remember, we even use the wrong words when we talk about cuts. It's cuts to programs, but the budget is actually, we're just reducing the increase in the budget. So it's, I'm sorry to make that. It's a hard
subject. It would be larger.
Yeah.
And I am not retiring either.
I just want to understand, I do agree that if we can meet all 21 classes to provide service for library and for the computer lab, that that certainly seems doable as a teacher. So with the library going to the 4 days, is the need for the library aid, because it's 4 days, do we currently have a library aid right now for supporting the library?
No.
So are we adding that in because they would need that support because they're only 4 days?
We don't know, but we are putting it in place in case. We're offering it to a longtime employee, and hopefully this is something that will.
So reduction for the
reading tutor, are you feeling that you don't need that support in the lower grades for additional reading groups?
Right. She's working.
Yep.
Because I feel like for being a first year teacher that
we're barely meeting those reading groups right now. So it would be less staff that we would have to meet the RTI reading groups, unless we're seeing it in a different way.
No, we actually, our reading scores for first and second grade and third grade have been, by the end of the year, have been pretty much on benchmark. We're doing an excellent job. I mean,
with the current,
and we still will have the interventionists and the IAs that are in place there to provide that. We've been doing a lot of work with differentiation. We're talking about people are doing guided reading. They're doing an excellent job in the classroom with that. We're starting to hit kindergarten students right now in the spring to be able to prepare them, bring them up to speed, because we have students that are readers so that they can enter into your classroom in first grade with some more skills. So I'm confident with what we have in place that elimination of that position, I'm confident we'll still be able to meet the needs of our students. I have no doubt.
So I just
want to
ask again, then.
I'm hoping that would be the case. So then I'm wondering if it's questionable if you would need library support, if maybe then that support could be put into the speech, which we seem to all feel like we're concerned about not having that additional support for whole class support in social services in the speech, versus putting that extra possible need in the library for shelving and maintaining that. Because it appears that the library has been maintained by the librarian without that support right now.
Yeah, one of the reasons that we changed the library position to full-time this year is because we wanted to have the library open 5 days a week. It was in the past 3.5 days when our former librarian was there. We're now reducing it to 4 days. The thought behind this process was to be able to possibly have that individual have the library open sometime on the other days that are off, the fifth day that is off, so students could come in, PK and K students, possibly even running library classes for those younger students. So those are the things we're considering. It would be an IA position. It would fall into the IA contract. What that looks like would be up for us to decide and design later based on the needs. So we're just looking right now at the dollar figure for a position, and we can look a little bit more into how that will be used down the road.
I'm not sure what they call them, but an SLP assistant. I know we've had some of them in the past. So that it's focused more in the speech and the social services, too. I guess what I'm saying as a teacher is if I have to, which I hate to have to prioritize, I would certainly prioritize for having the social services to support in my classroom versus library additional time.
Yeah, it sounds like that's a discussion that maybe could be continued around...
I don't think that needs to take place now.
That's what I'm saying, yeah, but in terms of our charge on the dollar amounts, I think we've given you, you're good. Yes, we can. The nitty-gritty of us as a committee cherry-picking precisely what happens there, hopefully you can work that out in a
Absolutely.
Better way. Yeah. But I'm just now hearing, is the library going to be open the whole time?
No. 4 days a week.
No, but
there
will
be a librarian there 4 days a week.
But, yeah, but we're not going to... Yeah.
The library assistant position will be 4.5 hours a day position.
But the space is always going to be open.
At least 4.5 hours on the one day the library.
A teacher would have, if the space is open and there is not a librarian in there, a teacher or a library assistant, a teacher would have to be in there
with the students.
Physical space would be accessible.
Yeah. So the idea of not having a library open in the lot
during the school hours.
Previously, it was only open 3.5 days.
Right.
It was, and it was closed in the garden.
Okay, so we're gonna move on. But thank you for all of your thoughts, dedication, contributions. We know it's hard. We know it's stressful. All we can do is thank you. So, welcome to stay. Our rest of our meeting. Okay, on to reports.
Hold on. Is there anything from the collapse?
Have you been?
Yes, I was there. May I present that report next?
Yes, sure. You may. Okay, and an email is fine.
I have some good information to share.
Oh, good.
I could do a committee update.
Okay.
As the representative to the town's capital planning committee, I have been participating in meetings, and we presented, as part of the most recent meeting to the committee, three requests that came from the Deerfield Elementary School. One was for improvement of the drainage in the front of the school for, I think it was $6,500. And then there was a request for $15,000 for door hardware and a request for $15,000 for interior finishes, which is principally replacement of carpets with vinyl, I assume VCT, vinyl composite tile, and some painting. Those were put in at $15,000 each, but had no specificity, so Trevor was there as a representative of the Board of Selectmen as well as the school committee, and we explained to them the issues we have with school choice, the pressures we're feeling, the fact that we would normally try to fund these expenses out of school choice. We no longer have that capacity, so therefore this is the start of starting to request capital needs from the town, and that it was part of a multi-year plan to replace door hardware and interior finishes. So they asked for greater input on specifically what that plan looks like, how many years, how much in total cost. We brought that back to Patty and Lynn. Patty gave me a draft today of a basic outline of what the costs are specifically, and we'll have the numbers to take back to the town. It'll probably be a three-year plan, it looks like.
3 year, 5.
Three to five year plan to take care of these needs rather than do it all at once. So,
yep. Mr. Cardabek, would it be helpful if I also sent in the projects we did take care of out of the school choice funds to show him that we have made an effort to take care of most of what we could ourselves?
Yeah, if you want, you could send it to him or send it to me, and I could take it to the next meeting.
I'll send it to you.
Yeah, it's the easiest way, just to give the committee a sense.
And then,
and that way it gets to the finance committee as well.
Okay, great.
Yep. Sure.
Great.
That's
great. Thank you.
We just have one thing. Good news. Many of you probably know, familiar with the Grinspoon Award. I don't know.
saw the art.
So we have, congratulations to Sue Scott. Sue is a part-time PE teacher here. She does mostly the adaptive PE classes. And she received the Greenspoon Award at Pioneer Valley. And even though she works part-time here, mostly in Pioneer Valley Regional, out of all of the faculty that are there, only one person is selected in Pioneer. In our district, it's done a little bit differently. And she was awarded this honor. It was a lovely article in the Recorder. I just want to recognize her because she really deserves that award. She has come here with so many initiatives, like the archery. She was really the one to be responsible for bringing archery because she had done that at Pioneer. She introduced the swim program for the LEAP students, which they are going on Thursdays to the YMCA in Greenfield to swim. And she has done a lot with Special Olympics. So I just wanted to recognize her. Our own DES Greenspoon Award winner will be announced soon. So we will come back to you and give you that information shortly. And I'm not sure the date of the dinner. I don't know, Lynn, if you know the date.
I don't have the file with me. But yeah, our the person that is chosen, each year they rotate between the union, and it's DES's turn and Frontier Middle School. And they get to bring family and guests.
It's in April or May, isn't it?
Yeah. Late so April, I feel like Deerfield will be celebrating two people this year.
That's nice.
So,
it's great. Terrific. Great news.
It's wonderful.
All right, superintendent's report.
I'm just going to talk quickly about some water testing that was done in our district and a letter that was sent home January 19th. And I believe this was after our January 4th meeting. Yes. So I wanted to bring you up to date on it. Essentially, the state has asked all school districts, all municipalities, if they want to have voluntary testing for lead and copper in the water. And our Bob Lesko, our facilities director, thought this was a good idea. It was a good idea for us to get ahead of the curve before it's mandated or whatever. So we entered into it. It was free for us, which it could have been expensive, but they took care of it. They went to all our schools. They tested all the water faucets everywhere in every school. And what they did is they did a first draft, and then they turned it off, and they tested that water, and then they ran it for 30 seconds. And then they took another. That's a half a minute. They ran it and took another test. So essentially what had happened was they took 76 samples, locations in this building. Five were showed lead levels in excess. So five of our faucets were in excess for consumption. And two showed excess levels of copper. We're not sure, you know, about copper for consumption. However, the first draw showed that we were over in five and two for copper, five for lead. But then when they went ahead and did the 30-second flush, and did it, we were within safe range. So what we're doing now is we've turned off the faucets, shut them off, made them not usable, and we're going to come in and change the piping that goes to it to make sure what happens when the water sits in the faucet, it just leaches a little bit from the solder that might be in there. And every time you run a faucet, you know, if you run it more than 30 seconds, it will be fine. But we want to ensure that we're really going above and beyond on that. So there are five faucets in this school that have tested above the level first drop. Everyone's fine after 30 seconds. But we are going to be meticulous in making sure that it's perfect all the time. So this letter was sent home, and these pamphlets were also sent home that explained the lead and the copper in the water. So we wanted to make sure that as our families are informed, that you're informed as well.
Thank you for that. I talked to DES. I went down to a hockey game this weekend with music director, and I talked to Lynn Rose down there. She was in charge of doing a lot of this testing and stuff, and she had asked me about it, and I hadn't seen the letter yet. It had just come home, so she said, oh, I'll help you with an action plan. So it's just nice to see you're already on top of that and getting an action plan together to fix that stuff. So.
Bob Lesko is really on it, and he is being very cautious.
Yep.
So there are, it is inconvenient in some of the little, the early childhood classrooms.
He's already fixed a few faucets.
Oh. He has already.
There was a plumber in on Saturday.
Great.
So addressing the areas, yep.
Yeah.
So he's really, he's taking it seriously. The bottom line is we did it voluntarily. We didn't have to do it.
Right.
But it was great that we did. It saved us money. And also, too, now we can reassure everyone that's involved that our faucets are safe.
Yep.
And if you're uncomfortable, run them for 30 seconds and they're really safe.
Good. So good to hear.
That's really all I have tonight, except nice. I do want to, again, thank Janine and her team. And the teachers and the IAs and everyone involved for the hard work that continually happens all the time. And it is tough. Budget season is always tough, and it takes its toll. So I appreciate everyone's understanding and everyone's openness, open-mindedness, and flexibility, and thinking outside the box. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, anybody have any questions? No? Okay. Anything else to do? So, nobody objects. Motion to adjourn.
In a second.
Okay. Anybody with some move?
Trevor. Aye.